So we've been going through this series called See for Yourself. And we've covered the ideas, come and see, taste and see, go and see. Just really simple phrases, yet God uses those phrases in the Bible to invite us to experience what he's doing in different ways. And he wants us to experience those things, not just learn about them. So you can watch those messages on our YouTube channel if you missed those. We've got another installment tonight, and then we'll conclude the series next week. Tonight we're going to explore God's challenge for us to test and see. Sounds a lot like taste and see, but this is test and see. There are certain things God actually wants us to test. He wants us, certain things he wants us to experiment with, which is kind of a fun thought. So tonight we're going to start by conducting a little experiment of our own. If you direct your attention over here. So that is Jared underneath that white suit. He has a bunch of little tubes of Mentos. So you've probably seen this or maybe heard of that. This is an experiment. We're going to see which produces the most amount of fizz and foam and everything. So you just kind of think which brand, which color of pop you think will be the winner for height or whatever. We didn't compare these earlier, so we're going to find this out together. Pepsi. That is Schweppes Diet Tonic Water. And it is a smaller bottle, so just for this. And Sprite glass. But if we do an experiment like this or not, probably isn't even on God's list of things that really matter to him. It's just for fun. But there are certain things that God wants us to experiment with. There are things that God wants us to experiment with. A handful of things his word actually tells us to test. Here's a few examples. We're to test spiritual things. 1 John 4, chapter 1 tells us not to believe every spirit, but to test the spirits to see if they're from God. So somebody claims to have a message from an angel or whatever, we're supposed to test that and not be spiritually gullible, not just go with everything that we hear, or not be spiritually arrogant either. But use some discernment, compare it to the Bible, compare it to what the Bible says about God's character. So it tells us to test our own work. Galatians 6:4 tells us not to compare ourselves against others, but to test our own work. So if we test ourselves against ourselves, like compare it to yesterday, compare it to last year, then we can see whether we're improving. We can see whether our service to God is deepening, if our relationship is deepening. And then we won't get prideful and we won't get depressed by the comparison game of comparing ourselves to others. And it tells us to test what God's will is. Romans 12:2 tells us to keep letting God's word renew us and transform our way of thinking so that we can test and approve what God's will is. So is that actually telling us to test God's will? It is. But it's an experiential kind of testing. In Romans 12:2, that in the NIV, the English words test and approve actually come from a single word in the original language, in the Greek. And it's a word translated as test in all the other passages. It's the verb dokimazo, and I don't know if I pronounced that correctly, but it means to test, prove, examine, discern, approve, try. All those things wrapped up into this word. So it's the idea that God wants us to figure this out and experience it. That's the kind of testing he's asking for these things. Is this spiritual idea from God? Then let's embrace it. Is my service to God's kingdom improving or deepening? Whether it is or isn't, let's keep making adjustments so it can keep improving. Is this God's will? If so, then let's experience it. Then we'll be able to verify whether his will is good and pleasing and perfect like the Bible says that it is. We'll get to experience that firsthand. But for the rest of our time tonight, I'd like us to consider a specific question. Should we or shouldn't we test God? Test the spirits? Yes. Test my work? Yes. Test if something is God's will? Yes. What about testing God himself? Well, in Luke 4:12, Jesus responded to a temptation from Satan, and he quoted a verse from the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 6:16, said, "You shall not put the Lord your God to the test." So that's a bad thing. Basically, anywhere in the Bible that talks about testing God, it's in a bad way. There were consequences, and it was always testing in a rebellious sort of way. As in testing the boundaries, as in pushing back against God's authority. And God doesn't respond well to that, and by nobody in any kind of leadership position responds well to that. But let's refine the context just a little bit for that. Whenever we read in the Bible about people testing God in a bad sense, it's always in this context. God does not want us to test his patience with disobedience. God does not want us to test his patience with disobedience. If you read the book of Exodus, for example, it is filled with one example after another of the Israelites testing God's patience by disobeying him. And they kept experiencing his curses because of that instead of the blessings that he wanted to give them. He wanted to give them right away, but they had to wait and put it off. And this is kind of a recurring theme throughout the Bible. So God does not want us to test his patience with disobedience, but he dares us to test his blessing with our obedience. He dares us to test his blessing with our obedience. And there's one particular area that the Bible challenges us to do this in. And we're going to look at a passage in Malachi chapter 3. Malachi is the book right before the New Testament. It's the last book of the Old Testament. So if you can find Matthew, it's the book right before that. Malachi 3, we're going to read verses 8 through 12. You're encouraged to follow along on a Bible app or grab a Bible. There's some in the center aisle tonight. So Malachi 3, verses 8 through 12. I'm going to read in the NIV. It says, "Will a mere mortal rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how are we robbing you? In tithes and offerings. You're under a curse, your whole nation, because you're robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven, pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not drop their fruit before it is ripe, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty." Test and see. A lot of times we hear this passage in the context of a church offering. Sometimes just verse 10, sometimes verses 8 through 10. But I included those last couple verses to remind us that this was given in a particular context. And I want to explain what that context was. So we'll give just a whirlwind history lesson right now. So last week we talked about this civil war that happened in the nation of Israel, divided into two kingdoms, the northern kingdom of Israel, or Samaria after the capital, and the southern kingdom of Judah, where Jerusalem was. And we read a piece of history last week where God delivered the capital city of Samaria out of enemy hands. But then after that, they kept sinning, they kept following idols, they kept practicing evil, and so eventually God's patience ran out, and the Assyrian Empire came in and conquered them, carried off the survivors to a different land. And then another empire, the Babylonians, conquered the Assyrian Empire. And by this time, the other kingdom, Judah, had pushed the end of God's patience. And so God let them get conquered. And those survivors were carried off to another land. Then the third empire destroys the Babylonians, and this was the Medes and the Persians. And under the first king of the Persians, the first emperor, God spoke to him, and he decided to let the Jews start going back to Jerusalem to rebuild the wall, to rebuild the temple of Jerusalem. And so that took way longer than it was supposed to with those building projects, but they finally got it done. And this was the audience that Malachi was writing to. They were the exiles returned back to Jerusalem. They had rebuilt the temple. They had reestablished the law of Moses, the temple sacrifices, all that. They had gotten back into the groove, kind of. They were sort of doing this, but their heart wasn't in it. And so Malachi, the purpose of Malachi's message was to confront this half-hearted, half-obedience. So, and in this part of the book that we read, he's talking about the tithe. And the tithe's the first 10% of our income that's supposed to go back to God. And if you've been to his house before, if you've been to church before, you've heard that, I'm sure. But let me explain that just a little bit deeper. The tithe was how God provided for people serving in vocational ministry. Even back in those days, under the Old Testament law, the tithe was how God provided for people serving in vocational ministry. In the time of Malachi, this would have included the priests who conducted the ceremonies, who slaughtered the animal sacrifices. It was the scribes who made copies of the Old Testament law. It was the rabbis who taught God's word, the Old Testament, to his people. It was the singers who led worship. It was the temple police who guarded the temple. It was the custodians who cleaned up after everybody. It was anybody who worked in vocational ministry. They weren't selling anything, and so this is God's means of providing for them and their families. That's why God said in Malachi to give the full 10% that there may be food in my house, because that was God's provision for these people. And the tithe was also the source of all the other ministry-related costs. If they need to replace some cedar boards in the temple, if they needed to fix some gold trim that got bent out of shape, if the worship team needed a new lyre and flute, if people were tithing, they had the means to do that. And same is true today. But Malachi was writing this because God's people were not tithing. They weren't giving a full 10%. And you can imagine the excuses they gave for that. Oh, God doesn't need my money. He's king of the universe. Why does he need my money? Or those rabbis are always talking about money. They just want my money. I don't trust them. Or, man, I'd really like to get that new goat to keep my lawn mowed. Or, I'd like that new outfit to show up at the temple services in. If I give God 10%, that only leaves me with 90%, and I'm not sure that I can have the lifestyle that I want on that 90%. And whatever excuses they made at that time, they're probably not that much different than excuses that we make today. Let me just state for the record, contrary to the message that's sometimes portrayed at community churches, God does not command Christians to give a full 10% to the local church, and then if there's anything left over after that, give it to missionaries or campus ministry or Christian radio or food bank, whatever else. There's nothing in the Bible to substantiate that. And actually, the New Testament never even commands Christians to give a tithe. What? I've heard this all the time. The Old Testament contained God's law for the Jews, but the New Testament is God's law for Christians. And if there was ever confusion about, well, do I still have to follow the Old Testament laws as a Christian? Acts chapter 15 answers that question completely. It's, no, we don't have to follow the Old Testament laws. So Christians can have bacon and can get tattoos and do all these things that the Jews of the Old Testament weren't allowed to do because it was against their law. But some of those commandments were recommanded in the New Testament. Love God, love your neighbor, don't murder, honor your parents, like stuff like that. So if it was recommanded, then it is for us. But the tithe wasn't actually ever recommanded for the New Testament. So tithing isn't commanded in the New Testament, but generosity is. Tithing isn't commanded in the New Testament, but generosity is. And as Christians, we don't abandon the Old Testament. We still include it in our Bible because it provides a rich history for our faith, and it reveals more of the character of God for us. And it is full of positive and a lot of negative examples that we can learn from and apply to our lives. And that's the case here with Malachi. So tithing isn't a law for us, but the principle behind the passage still applies to us today. Generosity is our instruction. Think about that word for a moment. Over in Midland, there's a baseball team, a farm team. It's called the Loons. If I go over to Midland to watch a Loons game, and I pull into one of those close parking lots to the stadium, and there's a charity there collecting a parking fee. If the sign says, parking $5 goes to this charity. If I pay my $5 to get that parking spot that's close to the stadium, am I being generous? No. If I pay $7 or $10 or $20 to park in that lot, then I would be generous. So generosity is giving more than what is expected. Generosity is giving more than what is expected. If I'm just doing what I'm expected to do, that's nothing special. So if God set the standard in the Old Testament with the tithe and said, okay, you have to give 10%, that's the law, and then Jesus comes along and gives, generously gives his life to pay for our sins so we can be restored to God, forgiven, be adopted into God's family. And God's new standard for followers of Jesus, okay, now I want you to be generous. And why would we imagine that generosity starts at 0.5% or 1%? Doesn't it make a lot more sense that generosity starts where the old standard was, at 10%, and then would move up from there? So I think it's compelling to believe that our generosity should start at a tithe and go up from there. And especially when we look at the examples God gives us, in Malachi and other places, we should want to do that, to experience what God's challenging us with. Take a look again at verses 9 and 10. Remember, this was written when the tithe was the law. People literally owed God this money. But let's apply it to our choice of being generous or not. We have the choice. We have the freedom. So, verses 9 and 10. You are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty. See if I'll not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. Test me and see. That's what God challenges with. God makes it abundantly clear and simple. If you disobey, you'll be cursed. If you obey, you'll be blessed. But the choice is yours. You get to choose. Which one are you going to choose? Here's this principle in the New Testament, the way it's written in the New Testament. This was written in the context of an entire chapter about generosity. It's 2 Corinthians 9. Verse 6 says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. This isn't the context of farming. It's a farming illustration talking about generosity. If we're a little generous, we'll get a little blessing. If we're greatly generous, we'll get a greater blessing. Will God actually curse us if we're not generous today? I don't know. But I know he will withhold blessing that he would have given if we were generous. And that's kind of like a curse if we're not getting a blessing we could have received. And I know from experience that if I keep 100% of my income, I'm going to struggle with it. It's not going to go as far as I think it should. Even though mathematically it should be way easier if I keep 100% than it should be for me if I keep 90% or an 89%. But here's the thing. God can do way more with 90% that's blessed than I can do with 100% that's not blessed. God can do way more with 90% that's blessed than I can do with 100% that's not blessed. And Heather and I know this from experience. When Braden was born, we had a combined income of about $25,000, which is not a lot of money. And yet we still committed to tithe a gross amount, 10% of that gross amount back to God. And God has blessed that so much in our lives. 18 years later, we make significantly more than that, but still, our combined income is quite a bit less than the combined income of the average dual income people our age. God has blessed our 90%, 89%, 88%, whatever we're giving, and done way more with it than we could have done by keeping it all to ourselves. And think about the imagery that God uses in the book of Malachi. It says if we test him in this area of our finances, if we experience that experiential testing, he'll open up the floodgates of heaven. It could be financial blessing, maybe not. It could be relational blessing. It could be ministry blessing, could be business blessing, could be physical blessing. He leaves that part open-ended up to him to answer that, but it will be blessing that's better than we can imagine. The idea of floodgates kind of reminds me of our Mentos experiment over there, that God's blessing is just ready to burst forth if we take him up on this challenge. But, you know, our demonstration over here is kind of a pale comparison. The phrases floodgates of heaven that Malachi used here is the same words that God used to describe when the sky opened up for Noah's flood. The floodgates of heaven will open, and it flooded the entire earth. And that's the words that he used to describe the blessing he wants to give us if we trust him with our finances. God wants us to test him in this, see if he actually does bless our generosity and our obedience. And now, it doesn't mean if you drop $100 in the offering next week and wait a moment, kind of look around, and if nothing happens, snatch it back before it gets too far. Like, it's not going to be an immediate thing. Instead, here's what we should do. Test God by developing a habit of generosity. See what he does over a lifetime of faithfulness. Test God by developing a habit of generosity and see what he does over a lifetime of faithfulness. Like, it was hard when Heather and I were starting out to tithe, but we did it, and now we're experiencing the fruit and the blessings of that in great ways. So we're not talking prosperity gospel here. You know, life still happens. Bad things are still going to happen. People that we love are still going to get sick, and we're going to sleep through our alarm and be late for work or class or whatever. Bad things are still going to happen. We're not saying that. But if we trust God, if we test God with this, he's going to give blessing. And we're going to experience that. He makes the choice as simple and clear as possible. Keep 100% without God's blessing, maybe even a curse, or practice generosity and experience that blessing. Yeah, for whatever reason, it's still something that we wrestle with. Like, 100%. Kind of reminds me of a movie clip that we're going to show. This is from Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
Don't push this button, because that will set off the bomb immediately, and we'll all be dead. Now repeat back what I just said. No! That's the button that will kill everyone! Try again. No! Does anybody have any tape out there? I want to put some tape over the death button. Nobody has any tape!
God gave us the free will to make choices, but sometimes I wonder if God wants to find some tape just to block off some of our choices. You know, it's so clear. Here's the blessing button. Here's the curse button. And we're like, it's 100%. I am Groot. It's 100%. Here's the blessing button over here. I considered putting the offering after the message tonight, but I chose not to. I chose not to even kind of bring that up to Grant or to Annie, because the goal isn't to bump numbers for a week or two. The goal is to disciple you guys, to develop generosity in your lives, and to start establishing that, to want to establish that for a lifetime. So you can experience God's long-term blessing from that. So test God in this and see if he will open the floodgates of heaven with his blessing. It's our choice to experience it or not. Let me pray.